Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our Tuesday night prayer meeting. Pastor Brian Pettrey here. So thankful tonight that you've joined with us, that we can go before a throne of grace and call on God so that he might do great and mighty things. You know, I was recently reading it's part of a poem by John Newton. He was the writer of Amazing Grace. He said, "Thou art coming to a king, large petitions with thee bring. For his grace and power are such, none can ever ask too much." That's a really good thought. We've got the opportunity to come before God, who sits on a throne, who rules over everything, and he wants to rule his grace and his mercy into our life tonight. We have to believe that. We have to come with expectant hearts. And tied into that thought is a passage that comes from Ephesians, where Paul, praying for the church at Ephesus, said that God wants to do exceedingly and abundantly beyond what we could ever think, hope for, ask, imagine. He wants to do great things in our life tonight. Do you believe that? I hope you do. I do. I'm excited to call on God that we can begin to see his grace flow. Jesus said when we come and call on him, when we pray, that's what allows the kingdom of God to come. So imagine that. We have this privilege to help bring his kingdom into our world tonight, into our lives in a personal way. But this isn't just about us. This is about the world God's put us in. Maybe to set that up and to get our hearts with some anticipation to pray for things. You know, we pray for prayer requests that come in on a continual basis. And here's some praise reports that have come from people that have sent and called in, like we're doing tonight, for special needs. This was from a lady named Mandy. She had a brain aneurysm. And we've prayed for her, and with the brain aneurysm, it leveled out, that she got healing. She had to do some rehabilitation, but she's gotten back all of her ability to function, and she was at a point where she was losing hope, didn't see the point of life, and people have been praying, and her situation has turned around. It's things like that that we have the ability tonight to make a difference in, and so we're going to take about 10 minutes now to see prayer requests that are going to scroll down the screen. Would you begin, even before you pray, to ask the Spirit of God to help you to really intercede in a way that is going to allow God's touch on these things that we're going to call on him for to happen? Prepare your heart, but believe God to do great and mighty things. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to continue to worship the Lord. How many know that He is our refuge and our strength today? Can we just continue to worship Him and love Him today? Glory to Your name, oh God. Let's sing to the Lord. God is. Thank you, Lord, for being our refuge and strength, oh Lord. Thank you that we can hang on and hold on to all of your promises today, oh God. Can we just lift our voices and thank the Lord? Gracias, Señor. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for covering us, Lord. Thank you for the cross, oh God. Thank you for your nail-scarred hands, oh God. Thank you for your blood, oh Lord. You're worthy, oh God. You're worthy of our praises, oh Lord. Thank you for your strength, oh God. Hallelujah. rejoicing in your presence. To hide.
Hey, well, thank you for taking time to pray for those announcements. Thank you for your faith. Your faith makes a difference as you look to God and you call on Him. You've literally changed lives for people tonight because God's grace, He's going to be faithful to your faith to impart grace, to bring help, to bring comfort, to bring healing in so many different ways. So I thank God for His faithfulness, but I thank God for your continued intercession and faith. He's going to honor it. Grateful for it. I want to take a second to just remind you of a few announcements we have. I want to talk about the young adults for a second. The young adults have a number of things playing out this week online, Wednesday night, Thursday night, Friday night, something to keep you engaged. But Thursday night, special evening, Pastor Cymbala is going to be sitting down, just having some kind of real talk, just different subjects, different things. You're going to have a great conversation. Don't miss that. If you are a young person between the ages of 13 and 18, our teen ministry has something so good for you. Friday night, there's going to be an evening of worship, and encourage you to have your kids tune in, or if you're a young person watching this right now, why don't you send out a couple of links to different people. We want to get as many people on the platform as we can and get young people looking to Jesus and opening up their heart through a night of worship and encouragement. You don't want to miss that either. And then finally, just a reminder to parents, we have every Sunday something so well done, so special. God's blessing is on it. It's for it's kind of a church service for the little ones. Why don't you go online for those details to find out how to make the connection for that, for the teen ministry, for the young adult ministry. Really great things to encourage you, keep you connected. In this season, you got to stay connected. And I want to also take a second and just thank you for your giving. We want to encourage you to continue to give. It's what helps to make all of this possible, all the programming that we have. And you've been so good to continue to honor God with what He's blessed you with. And we want to encourage you to continue to do that. You can't grow weary in well doing. And one of the great ways that we express our faith and the way that we give to God is through our tithes and our offerings, our resources. So thank you for it. And we're going to take a second and you can look at different ways to give.
The Brooklyn Tabernacle has made giving simple through Secure Give. You now have three ways to give your tithes and offerings from the comfort of your home. You may use your cell phone to text BT Give and your gift amount to the number 74483. For example, to give $20, just text BT Give 20 to 74483 or click the Give Now button on our website at giving.brooklyntabernacle.org or download the Secure Give app on your mobile device and enter the Brooklyn Tabernacle on the search screen. Please go to giving.brooklyntabernacle.org for more information.
Well, we're going to take a second now and we're going to look to God's Word to encourage us, to try to build us up in our faith. The passage we're going to be looking to is 2 Corinthians, the first chapter, verses 3 and 4. And what I want to do is, with all the challenges that are going on in our lives, with the difficulty, the things that bring suffering and pain, sometimes it can be overwhelming. I was talking to somebody the other day, and they were just like, I can't take any more input. I can't take any more difficulty. And I think a lot of us can feel that way from time to time. Maybe that's where you are tonight. Well, this passage of Scripture is going to encourage us because God longs to comfort us through the challenges, through the difficulties. So the passage starts off and it says this. 2 Corinthians, 1st chapter, verses 3 and 4. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus. God is a merciful Father and the source of all comfort. He comforts us in all of our troubles so that we can bring comfort to others. You know what I think is interesting, even as I read that and I hear what Paul is saying, all praise to God, all praise to God. The backdrop that Paul is speaking from as he writes this letter to the church in Corinth is one of suffering. It's one of unrelenting trial. Paul's been chased all over Asia and throughout Europe. He's been hounded by people who've tried to kill him and who've tried to undermine his message. He's been stoned. He's been beaten. He's been opposed on every front. He's faced adversity in ways that very few people will ever know. And imagine, in spite of all of that, you would think he would be like, where is God? How is there a God? Because of what he's trying to do. He's not just trying to live a life. He's trying to live for God. He's trying to proclaim the message that is the hope of the world from God. And what does he get for it? There's no ease. There's no comfort, it would seem, outwardly. And yet he says, all praise to God. Hopefully by the time we conclude, God's word is going to stir our hearts to make us want to praise him for the comfort that he's given and the comfort that he wants to give and the comfort that he wants to bring through your life to bring hope to the world. That's what we're focusing on, the comfort of God. Where does comfort originate from? It originates from God, his heart of mercy. He's a father full of mercy. When you think about what mercy is, I've got four kids. I'm a father. There's nothing I wouldn't do for them. Last night, my daughter was playing with this little bunny that she has, and it scratched her, and she started crying. I mean, she started really crying, and I was in the other room, and I immediately, when I heard that cry, I came running to see what had happened. Because of my heart that has pity on any kind of a cry or any kind of suffering that I think one of my kids would know, I immediately come. Well, that's the heart of a father, except what we know as mercy, what we think is a picture of mercy, it's a poor picture of who God as a father wants to be to each one of us, what he wants to be to you, how he longs when you think the days are dark and the suffering is so overwhelming and you don't know where he is. Know this, there's a father in heaven whose heart is stirred with pity. His heart is stirred with a compassion, not just to look at you from afar and not want to do something about it. He actually wants to engage you, and he has. Real mercy, and whatever the expression of that pity is, it engages life. It engages need. When it hears a cry, it comes running. God has come running to you and I tonight. And I want to remind you that it begins with Jesus. How do we begin when we see ourselves faced with whatever adversity is coming against us? How do we begin to refocus and recenter? We have to remind ourselves of the commitment that God has made in the flesh to come into the world. As God heard the cries of suffering that have come up as a result of our sin and all the pain that it's created, he didn't just sit and fold his arms and say, well, they didn't listen to me. They deserve it. They made their bed. Now they got to lie in it. No, his heart broke. And God began to engage us. And he sent, through this incredible plan of redemption, he sent his very son into the world to help you and I tonight understand and give us a literal picture of his heart for our suffering. And when you read the accounts of Jesus in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all the different stories that we have about him meeting a woman at a well who had already been married five times, and the lot that she was in, and the sense of shame and just being alone that she knew. And she wasn't even a Jew. She was a Gentile. Jesus comes to her, and he meets her, and he brings comfort to her and begins to speak of a love that would settle her from within. To a woman caught in the act of adultery who gets exposed before everyone, Jesus, he kind of pushes everyone away and tells her he forgives her. Picture of God's heart of mercy and pity for someone who's caught up in their sin. For another, a demoniac who can't even break free of the demons that would, a legion of demons that would haunt him and control his life and destroy him. He sends his son to that demoniac to help him, to break those chains, to free him once and for all. Whether it's someone stuck in their sins, someone oppressed by demonic influence, people that are hungry, Jesus' multiplication of bread when people were in a place after listening to him for days. They had nothing to eat. He feeds them. What is it a picture of? God cares about the details of our life, and he cares about them in such a personal way that he came and he met those needs. And for you and I today, it's a reminder that he wants to help us with whatever our challenge might be. If there's storms in life, he'll speak to them. What's your challenge tonight? What have you come into this prayer meeting with, weighed down by? Well, what becomes to you something greater than the comfort of God, than the comfort of Jesus himself? It's easy to lose perspective. That's why I'm reminding you of these things. These are stories that most of you already know, but I'm telling them to you because as I tell them, it helps us to be mindful. Wait, God, those pictures in the Bible of Jesus touching all kinds of need, all kinds of life, they're reminders to you and I that he still cares about us today. I was talking to a young man last night, 16 years old. His name is Kurt. He's a young guy, handsome, strong, intelligent. But he, since a little boy, because of where his family comes from, this part of the world that they come from, his family's like steeped back generations in witchcraft. And as we were sitting talking last night, I was telling him, as he was telling me stories, he's like, look, you guys are going to think I'm crazy. I don't even want to tell you these stories because every time I begin to speak about the things that I see, it weirds people out. They either think I'm nuts, and I don't think he's mentally, like, disturbed. He's because of what he's been exposed to, these realities are a part of his life. And as he started to tell us about, with fighting back tears, a young, strong guy fighting back tears because this oppression that he's known since a little boy, overwhelming to him. And I said, do you know, as I was trying to explain, God loves him. And as I started to explain God loves him, I used Jesus and the picture of who Jesus was to so many people influenced and possessed by Satan himself. The pictures that Jesus would come and touch people and set them free, I could see as I was talking to him, it was starting to stir up hope in him. Well, that's the point of these stories. That's the point of this scripture. That's Paul is trying to get us to focus our eyes on Jesus and what it means to our life. We prayed for Kurt, and I pray that you would remember his name and pray for him. Call on God, that he would make himself so real to him. He's not in a place where he's opened his heart yet to Jesus. He's never even really heard about Jesus. That's the second time I've talked to him, and I've prayed for him, but he's not to a point where he completely gets it. Pray that God would open up his eyes. He's aware of spiritual darkness. He sees it from time to time in real ways that you and I don't. So he's convinced that there's darkness. He just doesn't know that there's light. Would you pray that God would make that light real to him and that light would chase away all darkness and in Jesus' name, he wouldn't be tormented anymore? Well, that's Kurt, but I want to get back to you. Maybe tonight you're troubled and you don't know how to find comfort. Well, I want to bring this truth out in Jesus that I think is worth reminding ourselves of. He went to a cross. That cross represents the extreme length that God was willing to go to help you and I in our greatest need, whatever suffering might be from lack of food, from demonic oppression, from being exposed in your sin, all the different ways that life can become troubling for us. The greatest trouble of all is that sin separates us from God. Like we were made for him. We were made for his love. And God so wanted to comfort us, not just in the peripheral issues of our life, but the very core need that we have. He sent Jesus into the world to remove the barrier that would keep you and I from knowing him. If you're a Christian tonight, God has made his love real in you because of what he's done on a cross. And that's something that should, whatever's happening in your life tonight, sometimes we give too much time. We spend too much energy and effort. It's wasted energy. It's wasted effort because it just stirs us up and robs us of peace and takes away joy from life. We look at the circumstances. We look at the issues that create the suffering instead of the one who has been sent to undo the work of the enemy, to undo the work of sin and suffering and shame. He's come into the world to help you and I. And the cross is proof tonight that God is for you, that he longs to comfort you. Well, how does he give that comfort? When he was trying to explain to the disciples that he was about to depart, he had told them a number of times, I didn't come into this world to be some king that you're going to see sitting on a throne in Jerusalem. I've come into this world to die. One day I'm going to come back and things are going to be different. But for now, I've got to finish what my mission is, and that is to die and to be crucified. As he's tried to explain it to them, they freak out and they don't know how to make sense of it. And Jesus said, no, you don't get it, but I'm leaving because it's good for you that I leave, because when I do, I'm going to send you the Comforter. I'm going to send you the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, the hope that you and I have tonight, the hope that Kurt will have if he opens up his life and trusts in Jesus as a Savior, is that because sins are forgiven, God himself can now not just come alongside us, but come to the place where all of our troubles are. Our troubles aren't our circumstances. Our troubles are how we deal with our circumstances. And God himself has come to help us to think about things in the right way, to set our affections straight in the right kind of a way, that we might make choices that lead us in the right direction. The Spirit of God has been given to you, the Spirit of Christ, to help us through the difficulties of this world. In the same passages of Scripture, Jesus said to them, listen, in this world you're going to have all kinds of difficulty and challenge, but take heart, I've overcome. And in him overcoming, he helps us to overcome. When he overcomes the greatest trials of all, sin and death in the grave, it gives you and I hope that we can make it through any of the difficulties that we face, because the same Spirit that helped him to do all of these things is now with us. So you've got to begin to look at your trials a little differently. You've got to begin to embrace them. Paul, at the end of this letter to the Corinthians, he talks about a thorn in his flesh. He talks about how that thorn was given to him because of this natural instinct that we all have to be proud and to want to take life under our own care and take the reins and begin to, you know, either make ourselves something or try to figure out how we can best manage the best end in life for us. This issue of pride, this desire to want to control our lives, is the very thing that separates us from God. And because it's such a strong instinct, even in the Apostle Paul, God allowed a thorn. We don't know what the thorn is. Whatever your thorn might be today, know this, that Paul, in the place of suffering, he cried out to God. Imagine this. This is the one who said, all praise, at the beginning of this passage of Scripture, all praise be to God. He said that this thorn, he could say that knowing that this thorn was real and that this thorn was persistent. Three times, like Jesus cried out in the Garden of Gethsemane, take this away from me. I can't do this. The thing that created the agony that made Jesus sweat and bleed out blood, Paul used the same word to talk about his suffering. But Paul said, through the suffering, he said, I've come to realize this. Jesus said, my grace is sufficient for you. God allows trial, he allows difficulty, he allows those things that become overwhelming to us to take our eyes off of ourselves and to look to him, so that as we look to him, he can show up in the need that we have to bring the comfort and the strength that we need. In this world, God's not going to alleviate. It would seem from Scripture, he's not always just going to alleviate the difficulty of life. He's going to walk us through the difficulty to help us understand better who he is, that our faith might not waver. Paul said, I have come to delight in my weakness. I've come to delight in everything that strips me of my ability to manage my life on my terms. Because when through those trials, when Paul said even through the thorn in his flesh, he was looking to God and he was trusting him for what he could be in that moment, he came. And grace became so sufficient that Paul began to even rejoice in the trial and the difficulty. Whatever your trial might be today, perhaps it's a wayward kid. Maybe it's a spouse who they're not focused on the marriage. They're focused on other things. You could be in a financial crunch and you feel like the trial is going to break you. I don't know what form it comes in. Maybe it's some besetting sin and you don't know how to get free of it. I don't know. Maybe it's demonic influences that are just bombarding you and robbing you of peace in your mind. Whatever it might be, know this. If you're a Christian today, God is with you, and he's with you because he loves you, and he's with you because he wants to help you, and he's committed to you to never leave you, never forsake you, and to make Jesus real, whatever the need might be, to be your provider, to be your deliverer, to be your savior. Whatever it is, he's with you to help you with that. Well, nobody's here to say amen, but I'm going to say amen to that because that encourages my heart. God loves me and he wants to comfort me. How do I know it? Because he sent his son into the world to help, to give pictures of his love in so many different ways, but to remove the barrier that would keep me from even being able to receive the comfort of his very life, his very spirit. But because of Jesus, his spirit has been sent and he's with me to the very end. Make him tonight more real than the circumstances that would otherwise rob you of peace and make you forget about praising God but want to grumble and complain. That's a choice. We were focusing on the Word of God because as we reorient ourselves into what's really true, those other voices, they become less and the power of what is true becomes alive in us. So God is with you and he's going to help you. But the Christian life isn't just about us getting help from God. It's about us getting help from God so that with whatever help we've received, we can then go into a world and begin to tell others the hope that there is in Jesus. Could I identify with Kurt last night in whatever he's been through? Yes, but not really. I mean, there's things that I've felt in different ways in my life where do I think that there's demonic influence that would oppress me? Yeah, I've experienced it. But his is in a different way. But I was able to offer him the comfort that Jesus has given me with so many different examples. And those examples gave him hope. Those examples began to, as he was hearing it, they began, he was fighting back his tears, but they were touching chords in his heart of hope. Our lives, the suffering that we endure, the Savior who comforts us through all of that. Those issues, those challenges, those difficulties, those thorns, those things become the platform that God can use. You want to be an evangelist? You want to win people to the Lord? Just tell them how God has helped you through difficulty. If you'll do that, and you'll do it in a sincere way, you don't have to be a theologian. You don't have to be a missionary. You don't have to have a PhD in biblical interpretation. All you need is the reality of a Savior who's met you, sins forgiven, his presence with you. He's walked you through some dark valleys. Just tell people how he's walked you through those dark valleys and watch the hope that it'll bring. We are here to be comforted by God, that we might know him better, that we might be able to declare him better. The gospel is the hope of the world. But how is the enemy overcome? Through the blood of the Lamb and the power of our testimony. The testimony of what? Testimony of who God is and what he's helped us through in our lives. When I hear Paul say, I praise God, and I think about his life and I've read what he's been through, I go, if that guy can find comfort from God, then I certainly can. And so can you. So let's give our hope tonight. Let's give our attention. Let's give our focus as we bring closure to this on how God might help us. I want to pray three ways. Maybe, for whatever reason, you've tuned into this prayer meeting tonight and you're not a Christian. You're maybe like Kurt. You're hearing about Christ, but you know that that reality hasn't been made alive in you. Well, you can do that. It's as simple as this. If you believe that you, as a sinner, are destroying your life, then what do? You just acknowledge it. God, I'm self-destructing here. I'm leading my life in directions that aren't bringing blessing. Jesus, you came into the life that I would know that blessing. But I can't undo my sin and I can't be what I'm supposed to be, but you did that for me, so I trust you for it. If that's you tonight, repent of your way. Trust God for the way that he's given you, the comfort that'll settle you and give you peace once and for all. Repent of your sin, put your hope in what Jesus did 2,000 years ago on a cross, in a grave, resurrection life. He now sits to help you and to comfort you. If you'll come to him and begin to believe that, he'll come to your heart and he'll begin to comfort you. Secondly, if you're just a Christian that's come in here tonight and you are overwhelmed by some trial or difficulty, I want to pray that God's Spirit becomes so real to you that you're now caught up with the comfort God is with you right now than the issues at hand. Whatever that is, trust him for it. Christ is the answer to whatever your need, whatever your trial is. And then finally, I want to pray for us that God would help us to be people as we've been comforted to go into the world to bring his comfort, to bring the light of his love in ways that as we touch people and we reach out to them, they'll find the same hope that brings us here tonight. Would you pray with me? God, for those that are in a position where they've never trusted you before, God, help them even as they turn from their sin and trust you now. Would you come to them? It's not complicated. It's just, Jesus, would you help me? I believe who you are and I trust you to save me. God, for those praying that right now, Would you begin to make your comfort real, the comfort of forgiveness of sin, the comfort of peace with God? Make that real to them. And then make real, Lord, what we're praying for now for the rest of us. May your Spirit come and fill them. And may your Spirit even now for my brothers and sisters who are going through whatever difficulty, whatever trial would overwhelm them. God, remind them of the length that you've gone to. Remind them that you're with them now. Remind them that you're with them to make what those pictures are that we know of Christ real to them and the needs that they have. God, I thank you even now for how you're strengthening them. Your comfort means to strengthen. Strengthen them even now. And finally, God, I thank you for the privilege that we all know tonight. We know your comfort in different ways. And God, as you continue to strengthen us, as you continue to comfort us, you're doing it for the purpose that we would be your light in this dark world. Would you help us to open up our eyes and look around and see those that need comfort and help us to go alongside in practical ways like Jesus did and do what we can to make a difference. But God, help us to take advantage of the platform in the relationship to declare the comfort that you are, the comfort that you give, the comfort that we've received, that they might find hope for their situation just the same. God, we ask you to do all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I hope this message has encouraged you in some way. I hope that it's comforted you. It's my prayer that it would comfort you. Take a few minutes now and just meditate on what you've heard. If God spoke to you in some way, then take it in. Think about who Jesus is. Think about what he's done. Think about the stories. Think about his presence with you and think about how he's with you to comfort you that you might overcome and be that light in the dark world that he's put you in. God bless you.